Hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. The devastation in Turkey and Syria is simply overwhelming. It's beyond my experience, except for the Sri Lankan tsunami, the Haitian earthquake, the death toll of 15,000 and rising. You can contribute to the relief at the top of HughHewitt.com with food for the poor or text Hugh to... Oh, I screwed that up. 91999, okay. Good morning, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. The devastation in Turkey and Syria continues to astonish. The death toll is above 15,000. We are running a relief campaign with food for the poor. The banner is at the top of HughHewitt.com, or you can text H-U-G-H to 91999. And stay tuned as we continue to cover this disaster on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. With nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story of.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live in Studio West on this President's Day. Have a great President's Day. President Biden is in Kyiv, Ukraine, making a surprise visit with President Zelensky on the anniversary of the Russian invasion of Ukraine that has been turned back, in which the United States has assisted Ukraine in turning it back. Headline, Washington Post, Biden makes surprise trip to Ukraine ahead of Russian invasion anniversary. This is headline in the Wall Street Journal. President Biden visits Ukraine for first time since Russia's invasion. And then the New York Times, President Biden visit Kyiv, Ukraine's besieged capital. There's no New York Times reporter with President Biden in Kyiv. There is, however, a couple of Washington Post reporters there, so I go to their story. President Biden made a dramatic, unannounced visit to Kyiv on Monday in a display of strong American support for Ukraine, just 4 days before the anniversary of Russia's full-scale invasion. The high-risk visit to a Ukrainian capital that has been under threat of missile attack signals continued commitment from the United States, the largest financial and military backer of Ukraine's efforts to repel Russian invaders from its territory. Biden was spotted outside St. Michael's Golden Dome Monastery with Ukrainian President Zelensky. The Ukrainian capital was in a security lockdown with car traffic halted, even pedestrians blocked from certain streets. Shortly afterwards, an air raid siren went off in the city. It's very dramatic. It may be the most memorable moment of the Biden presidency to date. And I applaud the president for doing this. Super majorities of Americans support our support for Ukraine. I am among them. It is the front line in the world division between China, Russia, Iran, and the free world, with a bunch of people on the sidelines, including every other day, Germany. But the West supports Ukraine, and every Russian tank, missile, plane shot down, every Russian soldier killed is one more blow to that axis of evil in the 21st century. And President Bush, in those dire days after and months after 9/11, called the axis of evil Iraq, Iran, and North Korea. Well, this is axis of evil 2.0, and it's much stronger, China, Russia, Iran. My phone number is 1-800-520-1234. On this President's Day, I'll run through the news, but I'd like to know what you think of President Biden in Ukraine. I am 100% in favor of it. I'll be joined later by Salena Zito, by Josh Kraushaar, by Leland Vittert of News Nation. We're just very thrilled that all of the plans came together. President took a secret train from Poland to Kyiv. I'm sure he's going to be out of there very quickly. It's going to really make Putin have an aneurysm. And it's the kind of thing that Joe Biden can do because it doesn't involve giving a speech or wrestling with a teleprompter. He just has to walk around with Zelensky, and the Ukrainians will take heart. The capital that was supposed to be seized in a week is still standing a year later, and indeed, Russia's losses have been extraordinary. Poland called for NATO security guarantees to a post-war Ukraine. Now, Poland matters a lot to us. It's our strongest, most able ally on the border of the Soviet Union, although I am certainly hoping that Finland and Sweden join NATO, and then Finland will be like Poland, the frontline ally that has the most to risk and the most to offer in terms of forward defense. More on that in a moment. Dave Zavagno is a friend of mine in Cleveland, and since it's President's Day, I want to read you an email he sent to me yesterday. Hugh, I've met President Carter and spoken with him and continue to be an active contributor to his charity. One needs to search far and wide to find a more compassionate, hardworking, knowledgeable, and kind person. The hands-on billing work he championed, the work with Guinea worm disease, and the active charitable leadership he provided to many causes is very impressive. His recovery from brain cancer years ago is amazing. Most importantly, his personal negotiations and relentless pursuit of a peace treaty between Egypt and Israel stands alone as one of the greatest achievements in diplomacy over the past 50 years. Yes, he was a poor president, surrounded by the inept, and the press used Billy as their pinata daily. One of the many rebound presidents we have elected who struggled mightily in office and then did well in post-presidency years. All Americans should pause and pay their respects to the man Jimmy Carter and his achievements. I trust you can help inform your audience in these contentious times as to the man and the humanitarian he is and the good he did for so many, many people worldwide. Dave Zavagno. Dave is 100% correct. I had the honor of interviewing former President Carter on a book tour when he made to L.A. in 1994 when I was hosting the Nightly News and Public Affairs show there for PBS, Life and Times, which ran for a decade. And he was gentle. He was wonderful. He was terrific. In the post-presidency years, he did what HW and W have done, which is raise money for a lot of people, do a lot of good things for a lot of people, spend time with your family, don't bag. Now, he's made some missteps in his post, but not perfect. He's gone partisan. He's like his human rights policy during 77 to 81 when he was president, just occasional face plants. But the man is a legend for helping the homeless, building houses, Habitat for Humanity. He's a good man. And I salute him and pray for him and for his family as he enters hospice care this President's Day. Speaking of this President's Day, big New York Times piece, which I'll discuss in the Grand Old Pod later. The Grand Old Pod will be available at the Universe. I hope you are a subscriber to Universe. 5 days a week, we give you exclusive content on there. And today's President's Day show is a good one, and I encourage you to tune into it. It will be about President Biden in Ukraine and about Nikki Haley on the Sunday shows yesterday and Kamala Harris sitting down in the safe space for all Democrats, the only place they can go anymore, MSNBC. New York Times, Biden drawing up a 2024 playbook that looks a lot like the 2020 playbook. I'll talk about that in the Grand Old Pod. Nikki Haley walks treacherous road for GOP women. How absurd. I'll talk about that in the Grand Old Pod. Let's go to the news over the weekend. My phone number, by the way, is 1-800-520-1234. If you have a comment on President Biden being in Ukraine, 1-800-520-1234. Now, when President Bush went to Iraq in 2003 to serve Thanksgiving to the troops, that was bold. That was a war zone. That was bold. This is the same thing. Subsequent trips by President Bush and President Obama and President Biden have not been the same thing. We had better idea of what was going on. But W showing up in Baghdad and Biden showing up in Kyiv, they're just what presidents do. And yes, it's dangerous. Winston Churchill used to go to the top of number 10 when the bombs fell in Great Britain during the Blitz. And so physical courage is part of the deal. And I salute the president. Blinken and China's top diplomat. He's their foreign minister, Wang Yi, met on the sidelines of the Munich Security Conference. And the Chinese immediately announced it and said, we asked for the meeting and we looked weak again. Biden has tense meeting with Chinese officials amid spy balloon furor. Tense meeting means that Wang Yi yelled at Blinken again like he did in Alaska. U.S. warns China not to supply lethal aid to Russia. Not sure they care what this administration says. They've judged them, and they've judged them weak. In satellite images and video, hidden clues about an Iranian Air Force upgrade. Turns out the Iranians are going to buy from Russia the Su-35, their most advanced fighter plane. Look, it's China, Russia, Iran against the world. I do want to bring you up to speed on Sweden warning NATO against decoupling its NATO bid from Finland. Erdogan needs gazillions of dollars to rebuild his country. We were happy to help him do that, and we're happy to help other countries rebuild. But Erdogan has to stop screwing NATO. NATO is about NATO, not about Turkey's problems with its domestic issues. There are other stories out there, including the butchering of Ronald Dahl's books by a woke elite. Wokeism has descended into publishing. But let me begin in New York with Jason. Good morning, Jason. What say you?
Morning, Hugh.
Happy President's Day.
Oh, thank you very much. You too as well.
Thank you.
I agree that it's a bold move for him to be over in Ukraine. As far as being the right idea, that's a 50-50.
I'm a big supporter of the war. Why do you say 50-50? You got a minute.
All right. I'm 20 years military. I'm retired now.
Well, thank you for your years.
Them not being part of NATO, we're sticking our feet into dangerous territory. This country is not in a great shape to go into a war. Our military is not ready for it. So by jumping in there, that could get us into a war that we're not ready for.
Well, that's a good caution. No American troops are there. Special forces may be going there. And if Putin wants to start a war, he will start it, not us. And if he starts a war by engaging any of the NATO countries and invoking Article 5, we have to fight it. And it's going to be between two nuclear powers to make the Cuban Missile Crisis look like a dance. But I appreciate the sentiment. And Jason, thank you especially for 20 years in uniform. Much appreciated. It's President's Day. Call me about President Biden in Kyiv, 1-800-520-1234. Good morning, America. Significantly fewer of you are going to be awake on a national holiday today. But for those of you who do not yet know, President Biden is in Ukraine and just announced another $500 million of aid to Ukraine. But nothing advanced. I don't understand. Again, it's always do the least you can to keep them going, but don't upset Putin, as opposed to beat them. And that would involve F-16s, other older planes, lots more high-tech artillery. No American troops. This is one enemy that we face: China, Russia, Iran. It's one alliance. Every single piece of machinery that goes down in Russia is one we don't have to face in the future. Degrading the Putin regime. There are lots of stories today about how paranoid Putin has become, how they've fallen back into communist totalitarian tactics slowly, consistently, now in total darkness in the Ukraine, in Russia, and Ukraine needs our help to prevent that from happening. And good for President Biden going. I'm sure that cheers everyone. Send them the arms, they'll finish the job. 1-800-520-1234 is my phone number. If you disagree or agree, call 1-800-520-1234. A market update brought to you by Birch Gold. Markets are closed today, but Birch Gold isn't. You can go to hughgold.com or text my name, Hugh, to 98-98-98. Text H-U-G-H to 98-98-98 or go to hughgold.com. Request the free information kit on opening an IRA or a SEP IRA or 401k, or just, if you want a physical depository for your own gold, they will do it for you. But the best thing is to open an IRA with it. Gold keeps its value. It increases in advance of inflation historically over 100 years. And it's at $1,852 this morning, up from last week when I broadcast. And it's going to continue to march up because inflation isn't going anywhere. So hughgold.com, hughgold.com. Proud to have them sponsor thousands of five-star reviews. Birch Gold knows what it's doing. They operate the physical depository, and they are a legitimate third-party administrator of your IRA and your SEP IRA and your 401k, so the IRS doesn't bother you about it. You can't establish your own IRA with gold, but you can do it through a third-party depository, which is what Birch Gold is. Go get their information. If you're just going to buy gold, that's where I bought my gold from, and when I in the future do it again, it will be from hughgold.com. James in Ohio, Buckeye, 1-800-520-1234. Good morning, James.
Good morning. I disagree. They're not part of NATO, and we have too many issues at home, and I think that is a waste of taxpayers' money for him to travel when he can do all he needs to do over the phone.
You know, a visit in person has an enormous influence on the morale of a country beleaguered after a year. And there's nothing that really works in Ukraine anymore because Putin keeps throwing missiles at the infrastructure because he can't make advances on the ground. I know you disagree, but surely you must understand the impact on Ukrainian citizens to have the President of the United States show up.
Well, at this time when our country is hurting as way as it is financially and with everything going on, I just don't think he's putting American interests first.
Oh, I think he is, because and I understand you're not alone. About 3 out of 10 Americans agree with you, and 6 out of 10 Americans agree with me, and 1 out of 10 Americans doesn't know Ukraine or Russia on a map. But I appreciate the call, James. Have a great President's Day. Chris in Florida, you've got a minute, Chris. Good morning.
Good morning. I'm a Gold Star dad. I became acquainted with many of the families of the 13. The top most important aspect of Commander-in-Chief is protecting our nation and the lives of our soldiers, and every part of the Biden administration screwed up Afghanistan. And
oh my gosh, are you right? Chris, by the way, tell us about your son or daughter.
This one will be 16 years, Army Ranger in Iraq. Targeted by Iran, probably killed by a bomb made in Iran because of what his role was.
You know, that's why
Iran loved every moment of his life.
I tell you, that's why Iran's an evil country. Russia's an evil country. China's an evil country. And Chris, for your sacrifice on this President's Day and your family's grief, We thank you and pray for you, and thank you and salute your son. I appreciate your calling this morning. Don't go anywhere, America. Chris is absolutely right. The number one job of the President of the United States is to protect this country, take care of his troops. And that, by the way, is one of the reasons I support our aid to Russia, is that it sending aid means not sending American troops. Stand by, America. I'll be right back. 1-800-520-1234. Adam, I didn't hear the countdown there. Relieffactor.com. Time for me to take it out and show it to you. I've got it right here. I've got to remember to, it's beautifully opened, take my four pills, because I did my 5 miles yesterday up the hill for the first time since the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt has been limping around, and I was able to get out, beautiful day in California, and my carrying curcumin, resveratrol, and omega got me up the hill and back down. Later today, if it's another gorgeous Southern California day, I will be doing the same thing. I expect it will be crowded because it is President's Day, but we will be out there and doing it. I'll be thinking and updating you throughout the whole program, by the way, about President Biden's trip to Ukraine. So stand by. Relieffactor.com, $19.95, $19.95. Get you started. 3-week starter pack. 500,000 Americans use it. So should you. Stay tuned to the Hugh Hewitt Show. Good morning, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live on the West Coast. President Biden is in Kyiv, Ukraine. I want to remind everyone, yesterday's political items. I read two newsletters every day, news items by John Ellis and political items from John Ellis. Substack subscriptions. I like the product so much I actually invested in it because it's real news. It's just the summary of the news. Yesterday, John circulated a summary of about a half dozen polls from various places. And the one that stuck in my mind, I went and found it and just put it out on Twitter. If you're not following me on Twitter, I wish you would. I do mostly straight news plus the Browns, Guardians, Cavs, and the Ohio State University Buckeyes. Yesterday, Ellis, political items. Nearly 1 year into the war between Russia and Ukraine, American support for Ukraine holds steady. A stable 65% of U.S. adults prefer that the United States support Ukraine in reclaiming its territory, even if that results in a prolonged conflict. Meanwhile, 31% continue to say they would rather see the U.S. work to end the war quickly, even if this allows Russia to keep the territory that it has occupied in Ukraine. I am with the 65% and believe that, as President Reagan did with the Mujahideen in Afghanistan throughout the 80s, we ought to be doing with Ukraine whatever they need. Give them the tools. They'll finish the job. People agree and disagree. Richard in South Carolina. Good morning, Richard. You've been waiting the longest. Let's start with you. How are you? Happy President's Day.
Happy President's Day. I agree with you, Hugh. I'm not a supporter of Biden, but I'm glad he's there. And we should never forget that in the early 90s, at the end of the Cold War, Ukraine gave up their nuclear weapons to the United States, and which kept them out of the hands of terrorists. And we should do everything we can to support that country. Because I tell you, they're fighting that war, and if we're not careful and we don't support them, we'll probably all be in a big war soon. So I certainly am happy that Biden went there to support Ukraine at the one-year anniversary.
I think it's the strongest moment of his presidency.
I agree.
And it's not a very, there aren't many of those to pick from, but you're absolutely right. The tip of the sword right now in the war of freedom against totalitarianism is on the front line in Ukraine, where free people are fighting against the axis that is China, Russia, Iran. And not China particularly, but the Chinese Communist Party, not Russia, but Putin and his gang, and not the Iranian people, but the mullahs at the center of it. Richard, thank you. Let's go to Chicago and Gary. Good morning, Gary. How are you?
Good morning. I don't think this has anything to do with Ukraine and their position with NATO. This is totally regarding Russia and stopping their aggression. And I wish the administration would see that this is an opportunity to possibly shut down Russia for good without expending one American soldier if they would just give the Ukrainians everything they needed. And I think it is good to see Biden go to Ukraine.
I think it's the finest moment of his presidency on President's Day.
Yeah, I just wish they would see the opportunity to possibly shut down Russia for good.
Yeah, or actually convert it to a modern European nation. I was reading a long story on Putin yesterday, and they're reverting to complete Stalinist thuggery, and he thinks he's a czar. And I just put this on my Twitter feed. AP just reported President Biden announced another $500 million in aid, which is great, but no more advanced weaponry, no new advanced weaponry. They need fighters that they can fly. We've got them.
Totally agree.
We've got them. Our NATO allies have them, and the Pentagon, under President Biden's orders, will not send them. So it's like fight with one hand behind your back. I do not understand it, but I applaud him going, and it will certainly have a great impact. Thank you, Gary, for listening in Chicago this morning. Harry in Pittsburgh. Good morning, Harry. How are you?
Very fine. Thank you. After 20 years in Afghanistan and then the surrender, leaving behind $80+ billion of our weapons, and you think we should be giving F-16s to Ukraine? Who's going to fly them? Who's going to maintain them?
Oh, I mean, they got that. If they can't fly them, you don't give them. But it's not the world. They've got already fighter pilots who are flying advanced planes. They're just not as good as the F-16. And that I'm not saying the F-22 and technology that can be lost. And I don't think it in any way obscures that. I don't know how much we left in Afghanistan, but it was a lot. And we left a lot of blood and treasure there. and mostly it's the blood that bothers me, and we left a lot of allies there, and that's why Putin, I think, invaded Ukraine, is because he saw our reaction in Afghanistan. But Harry, the two aren't connected, except this is an American display of strength, and Afghanistan was the worst display of collapse since Vietnam.
We just spent $1.2 million shooting down three weather balloons.
We don't know that. Harry, we don't know that. You don't know that. I don't know that. We don't know what they were. One of them is at the bottom of Lake Huron. And it was a terrible execution of an important strategy. And we let the Chinese spy machine coast over to the United States and send all the data back to the CCP. Then we shot it down. And that was stupid. Turns out we shot at it in Montana and couldn't bring it down. So there's a question about the Pentagon's competence here as well. But this is, when you have a $31 trillion debt, we're not talking about real money here. You want to fix the real money problem, you got to fix entitlements. You want to fix entitlements, it's going to have to be bipartisan and a virgin birth. But it's got nothing to do with supporting Ukraine. The cost of a war would be a lot more if he engages Poland or any of the NATO allies. But I appreciate the call. Robert in Delaware, 1-800-520-1234. What do you say, Robert?
Yeah, I guess my concern is, can we get to this sort of a Yalta moment about what's going to go on in Russia with some people behind the scenes who are going to cut the legs out from underneath Putin? Because, you know, before we have World War III, what's going to happen first?
Well, you're right to be worried about that. I want to draw your attention to a Robin Dixon story in yesterday's Washington Post. Putin, czar with no empire, needs military victory for his own survival. And I am worried about escalation because I think Putin is nuts. And I do worry about that. But I think the likeliest way to deter him from ever using his nukes or anything to end up with World War III is to fight him on the front line in the Donbass. Their military is getting eviscerated and maybe even decimated. And I mean the old Latin sense, 1 out of 10 Russian soldiers dead. The body count is extraordinary. Their losses are so savage and huge because they're just throwing conscripts and prisoners into the front lines where it didn't work. They didn't train their people. Their military is being shut back, but he still has a nuclear weapon. You're right to worry about it, Robert. You're right to worry about it. But the best way to keep Putin in check is to beat him in Ukraine. Thank you, Robert. Randy in Tennessee. Good morning, Randy. Which part of Tennessee? Are you in Knoxville?
I'm in Knoxville. I'm actually in a bedroom community, Coryton, Tennessee, and that's the home of PFC Knoss, who was killed in the withdrawal, one of the 13.
I'm sorry to hear that.
His high school. They've renamed Tazewell Pike the Ryan Knoss Memorial Highway.
Oh, well, that's wonderful. You heard the Gold Star Father earlier. Maybe you heard them call in on this president, reminding us of the 13 Americans at the very end. I mean, we've more than 7,000 Americans died in Iraq and Afghanistan, tens of thousands wounded. That's why we do the Semper Fi Fund show every Memorial Day and every Veterans Day, to take care of the troops who got injured in the long wars. But what do you think about Ukraine, Randy?
I am very worried about poking Russia in the eye and seeing that maybe somebody like Putin could do something horrible to us for engaging in a proxy war with the Russians. I don't know, Hugh. You know, I'm a conservative Republican because Republican Party is the home of conservatism. I'm a little R with a big C. Man, 22 years of nonstop war. You just said all those poor our troops that got killed in Iraq and Afghanistan, and with no disrespect, because God love them, and I sure do, what did it get us? And why
It got us a lot in the Middle East, the Abraham Accords, a unified front against Iran, and a long-term deterrent there. We didn't. Oh yeah, we've got the Abraham Accords with the UAE and Bahrain and Morocco, and we will soon have Saudi in there aligned with Israel.
And now we have a puppet regime run by the Iranians, where all of our guys got killed. And
that is true. And I do believe the problem of Iran is a clarifying moment. Iran is, though, a country of wonderful people being ruled by a theocracy, and they killed our boys, and we killed Soleimani, and Trump had the right idea about bankrupting them. But we got to look at the world as it is, not, and we could have done things better. We don't, 2020 hindsight is perfect, but it doesn't mean we turn our eyes away from what's going on right now in the world.
We're asking for trouble, Hugh.
No, I'm not. I'm doing Ronald Reagan. You said
Russians, when we wake up one day and we've got an EMP or a nuke going off in New York City, nobody's going to be letting me paint their house because we want to get involved with a bunch of Ukrainians, the most corrupt country.
Okay, Randy, you're going off target here. I am with you. I do not want any American troops killed in Ukraine. The best way to secure America is if you are a small R, large C, go with the Reagan doctrine, peace through strength, and do what Reagan did. Never engage Russia directly. Do it through proxies and do it through weaponry. And this is Reagan 2.0 policy, poorly executed by Biden and Blinken, but nevertheless, it's still the same policy. Thank you, Randy. Alan in Ohio. Go ahead, Alan.
Good morning. Happy President's Day to you.
And to you, sir.
Here's a question for you and the large number of people. Are you ready to go and meet the Russians head on, because that's what we're doing.
No. We don't want a war with Russia.
We are doing this as a proxy. This is the same way when we went in and sent the little green men, as JFK said, into South Vietnam. This is going to be
No, it's not. We are doing what Reagan did.
Went into Kandahar.
Yeah, but Alan, stay with me through the break, so you don't have to rush. This is not the little green men, because we are not sending American troops to Ukraine.
Okay.
So your premise is wrong, right?
No, I don't believe so. You're gonna send fighters into Ukraine. You're gonna send F-16.
I would sell them or give them F-16, not American pilots. We do not get engaged in a war with a superpower. Proxy wars, what the Russians did to us in Vietnam, is exactly what we're doing to them in Ukraine. Give them the tools, they'll finish the job. Just like we fell in Vietnam, Putin will fall, I think, over Ukraine. But not if we abandon the Reagan peace through strength doctrine. Don't thank you so much, Alan. Don't go anywhere, America. More of your phone calls. President Biden is in Ukraine. If you're just waking up on a holiday, President Biden is in Kyiv. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. President Biden is in Kyiv with President Zelensky, and I am in the West Coast studio. And Salena Zito is in Yinzerland in Pittsburgh. She's been writing up a storm on Nikki Haley, on Ron DeSantis for the Washington Examiner, for the New York Post, for the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette. Salena, great story on Ron DeSantis. How long did you spend with the governor?
I spent an hour and a half, no, 1 hour and 41 minutes with the governor.
Those are two great columns. There's got to be more, right?
There is one more that's coming that will be in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette next Sunday.
Well, how did that come about? Because I'm envious.
asking. I've asked everyone that is wanting. In fact, I'm not actually in Yinzerland. I'm on my way to someone who I can't say, but is going to announce tomorrow. So I'm on the way to do that interview.
Going to Indiana, are you?
I did not say Indiana.
No, you didn't, but I know where you can drive to in a day and who might be running, but we will see. Salena, on this President's Day, President Biden, best moment of his presidency, going to Kyiv, doesn't require a speech. He put out a strong statement. What do you think of this?
As someone who has spent the past four days in East Palestine, I'm going to think that there's going to be a lot of people that's going to quibble with his decision to go there. And I understand all the reasons why he did, but there are people that are hurting really bad in Columbiana County in Ohio that are going to wake up this morning and just be so, I'm not even sure what the adjective is. I think it's brokenhearted, hurt, angry, that he made the decision to go there, and they have been waiting for someone, anyone with authority and gravitas to show up and tell them, we care, we hear you, we're not going.
I do believe you're honest. East Palestine, as Salena and I have talked about, is about 30 minutes from her and 30 minutes from my hometown, and I've been there many, many times. Jim Strzok, former California EPA administrator, former head of enforcement under H.W. Bush at EPA, wrote on his Substack yesterday about the complete travesty that is the East Palestine train wreck. And Salena, I would be afraid. And of course, the trial lawyers are there now and they're going to sue everybody. But it's shameful that Pete Buttigieg is not there and hasn't been there.
It is so shameful. It reminds me, and I'm old enough to remember this, of Black Monday in Youngstown in this way. At that time, the local church groups and the local unions organized several buses to go down to talk to President Jimmy Carter. And this is someone they supported. Senator John Glenn was with them.
We got to tell people what Black Monday is in Campbell and the Steel. What? Tell them about Black Monday, Salena.
Black Monday was September 19th, 1977. It is the day that changed steel industry forever up and down the Steel Valley, Mahoning Valley. Between 10 to 15,000 people all lost their job in one day.
Yep.
And these people traveled down to D.C. Carter knew they were coming. John Glenn had given him the forewarning. It was not a hostile crowd, and he refused to meet with them.
And on President's Day, the idea that no one has been to East Palestine. And I don't know what to make of the American Chernobyl. I don't think it's that. But
are people
afraid of it?
Here's what they're afraid of. Is that 1 year from today, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, there's a ton of attention there now. What will happen in those days? But this is an idyllic community. This isn't like Youngstown. This isn't like East Liverpool. The towns here are tidy and neat. There has been no sense of being stuck here because there's opportunity here. And there are no abandoned homes or abandoned industries. And they are fearful that once all this attention is gone and once all these experts, as you said, American Chernobyl, have gone, and this attention is gone, that when the real problem hits, no one is going to be there.
And no one will have been there. It's a massive leadership failure, but Pete Buttigieg does not realize his presidency is sinking. His future presidential bid is sinking as we speak.
Well, as a mayor, as a former mayor, he should be one of the first people to understand, get there yesterday.
Zito Salena on Twitter. Zito Salena on Twitter. And if you're not on Twitter, get there. It's for news. And you follow Salena by going to @ZitoSalena. You follow me by going to Hugh Hewitt and coming back next hour. Thank you, Salena. Happy President's Day. Hour number two, straight ahead, America. Stay tuned. Your phone calls, 1-800-520-1234. President Biden is in Ukraine. What do you think? 1-800-520-1234. Connection to me, Hugh Hewitt, on this, The Hugh Hewitt Show. Churches need to stand up for the unborn and fight the powers of darkness. Find out how you can join the battle by reading the book, Letter to the American Church, new from Regnery Publishing.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. The devastation in Turkey and Syria is simply overwhelming. It's beyond my experience, except for the Sri Lankan tsunami, the Haitian earthquake, the death toll of 15,000 and rising. You can contribute to the relief at the top of HughHewitt.com with food for the poor, or text Hugh to... Oh, I screwed that up. 91999. Okay. Good morning, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. The devastation in Turkey and Syria continues to astonish. The death toll is above 15,000. We are running a relief campaign with food for the poor. The banner is at the top of HughHewitt.com, or you can text HUGH to 91999. And stay tuned as we continue to cover this disaster on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
Morning glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live in Studio West on this President's Day. I know a lot of you aren't commuting to work today, but I am nevertheless here to tell you you're missing a big news day. President Biden is in Kyiv. Surprise visit. He went by train from Poland. Deeply secret. Air raid sirens went off when he was wandering around Kyiv with President Zelensky. And it's probably the most notable and significant day of his presidency. And I applaud him. I salute him for doing this. It is a very grand thing that he is doing, and I am glad that he is there. But incredibly, he just said, he's with Jake Sullivan, so I assume Sullivan, the National Security Advisor, briefed the press. We're not sending anything new in terms of weaponry. We're just sending more to what they've got already. Another $500 million of aid announced, which is great. They need it. HIMARS, ammunition, stuff like that. Send them the planes that they can fly. Send them everything that doesn't risk giving technology to the Russians by them capturing it on the battlefield. But send them everything, because it's a two-sphere world. On the one side, there is China and its, I don't want to call them allies. They're basically vassal states of Russia and Iran. And then there's the West. And the West has some people in it that are very weak, like Germany, led by the weakest person, and then very strong people like Israel and Poland. And we got to pull it together, and we've got to lead this coalition, because it's going to be another Cold War. It's Cold War 2.0. It's got a front that's opened up in Ukraine. We have to support the Ukraine. It's not a NATO country. They're not going to get into NATO. We got to get Sweden and Finland into NATO. We got to get Erdogan to back off, and we have to support the Ukrainians. President Biden issued this statement. As the world prepares to mark the one-year anniversary of Russia's brutal invasion of Ukraine, I am in Kyiv today to meet with President Zelensky and reaffirm our unwavering and unflagging commitment to Ukraine's democracy, sovereignty, and territorial integrity. When Putin launched his invasion nearly 1 year ago, he thought Ukraine was weak and the West was divided. He thought he could outlast us, but he was dead wrong. Today in Kyiv, I am meeting with President Zelensky and his team for an extended discussion on our support for Ukraine. I will announce another delivery of critical equipment, including artillery, ammunition, anti-armor systems, and surveillance radars to help protect the Ukrainian people from aerial bombardments. And I will share that later this week. We will announce additional sanctions against elites and companies that are trying to evade or backfill Russia's war machine. Over the last year, the United States has built a coalition of nations from the Atlantic to the Pacific to help defend Ukraine with unprecedented military, economic, and humanitarian support. And that support will endure. Better late than never. Remember, it was President Obama's weakness that initially invited Putin to invade in 2014. It was our collapse in Afghanistan under President Biden that encouraged Putin to try and seize Kyiv and the rest of the country. So better late than never. It's the best moment of his presidency. Send them the planes, Mr. President. Tony in Kentucky, 1-800-520-1234. I'm taking calls from people only on Ukraine. The president's visit, 1-800-520-1234. What do you think, Tony?
Thank you, Salena, Zito. And to all the great truckers in America like me, I'm sorry, you, but this guy carries no credibility. He's been totally he has not been proactive on anything, not in the last 2 years that I've been watching. And so everything that he's done is reactive. It just carries no credibility. I'd like to hear that question asked amongst citizens of this country. Does he have any credibility going over there? I think you would get an astonishing response to absolutely no. Send anybody. I mean, send somebody. Send Condoleezza Rice. She has credibility. Send somebody.
Well, you know, Tony, the presidency, even when occupied by a weak and infirm old man, is still the presidency. And he's the head of state and head of government of the United States of America, the strongest power in the world. And for him to go to Kyiv is a significant act. He doesn't have credibility, but the United States does. The president has credibility, not Joe Biden. He is weak and infirm, but this is the best thing he's done. So let's, you know, he got it right. Let's salute him for going, and then point the fact that the half measure that he's doing is just another half measure. And I wish he'd go all in, not with American troops. Want to say it again. No American troops. By the way, where are you driving today, Tony?
on my way to Louisville, but I go all. Let me tell you something, Hugh. I've got friends of mine that tell me they don't even want to drive up there near where the
East Palestine. Yep, East Palestine. Look, I pray for those people. I know East Palestine. I've been to East Palestine. East Palestine is a friend of mine. It's not far from Warren. If this had happened in Warren, I'd be urging my brother to get the heck out of Dodge. Absolutely. I don't know what it's going to do to the town, but I do know it is criminal what Pete Buttigieg has not done. And the President of the United States ought to go there as well. But that does not detract, I think, from the power of the United States being in Kyiv. It's a symbol, and it's about the best thing Biden can do. It really is.
I don't know, man. It just got a bad taste in my mouth.
Well, look, we got to beat him. I don't know who we're going to nominate. I'm in Switzerland. I will be interviewing everyone and all of them who want to come on the show, who's a legitimate candidate. But I am not confident that we can beat Biden if we close our eyes to the fact that 65% of Americans supporting Ukraine. And 30%, and they're equally distributed in left and right, are isolationists. But let's not go down that road. Bonnie in Texas, 1-800-520-1234. Where are you living, Bonnie? Which part of Texas are you in?
I live in Addison. How are you?
I'm good. Good morning.
I'm kind of half and half on the whole thing. I wish the president would spend more time doing more things for our country. Oh, I don't know, the border, the Keystone Pipeline he shut off, people in this country who are out of work. But, I digress. However, I understand your point of view, but I just really don't think it was the most important thing for him to go to the Ukraine, where giving so many weapons and so much money. I know I sound like a terrible person, but I'm sorry.
No, you don't. Really, no, you don't. You're with 30% of Americans want us to do everything to get the war over with, and they don't really care about Ukraine. But you're part of that 30%. I respect everyone's point of view. I believe with Reagan, the man I worked for 6 years, that peace through strength is the only way. And when you have a third party willing to fight the front and sacrifice their men and women, all we're doing is, and it's, you know, another half billion. We have a $31 trillion debt headed to $50 trillion over 10 years. $1 billion is a rounding error. So let's round the error against Putin and hope for regime change there from inside. Not us. We're not going to bomb the Kremlin. We're not going to shoot at Russians. But this is having a terrible impact on Russia and Russian elites. I urge you to go read that Washington Post story, and I thank you, Bonnie, for your call. Frank in New Mexico, 1-800-520-1234. My lines are wide open on President's Day. I'm surprised by how many people are awake this early on President's Day. Good morning, Frank. Hello, Frank. Are you there?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me, Hugh?
Yes, I can. Go ahead.
I don't agree with you, Hugh.
Well, that's okay.
I think after this conflict, or this little war, has been going on a year, and Joe Biden going over there now does not really carry any weight with me. He's neglecting duties here, emergencies here in the United States.
Well, we don't disagree about that. He should have been in East Palestine last week.
Yes, and I think that should take priority over him. He's just an ambassadorial type little figurehead.
No, Frank. If you're a Ukrainian, this is the biggest day since the war began. This is the President of the United States of America coming to your capital city and walking around when the air raid siren is going on. It's as though FDR went to Great Britain during the Battle of Britain.
Okay.
Well, it's that big. It is that big. It's the President of the United States in your war-torn, beleaguered country. And, wow, that's a big deal for them.
Yes. Well, we're already sending aid.
Yep. And so... The president can't give a speech. He can't give an interview. He is infirm. but he can get on a train in Poland and go to Kyiv and walk stiffly around Kyiv and then get the heck out of Dodge and do more for the effort there and encourage Ukrainians than anyone else in the world can do. And I applaud the President of the United States on President's Day for doing that. 1-800-520-1234. You do not have to agree with me, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. I'm posting updates over at my Twitter account. I encourage you to go and follow me there. Stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by PhD Weight Loss and Nutrition. Go to myphdweightloss.com to learn more.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt. Very happy I did not take today off. You did. But President Biden, in the high point of his presidency in Kyiv as we speak, he may be leaving soon. You can't leave the President of the United States in a war zone for a long time. It's got to get him in and out. But it's clearly a great thing for Ukraine. Callers are divided. Let's get back to a Mac in Virginia. Good morning, Mac. You're on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Thank you for taking my call, Hugh. Who is anybody kidding? He's there in Ukraine to deflect the speech that...
You're breaking up on me, Mac. Are you? I can't hear what you're saying.
Okay, my comment is that he's not fooling anybody. The president is there in Ukraine to deflect the heat that... John Lemon has been receiving.
Yeah, you're not coming through, Matt. Thank you, buddy. Next time, get a better connection. Arn in Maryland. Hey, Arn.
Hey, I just wanted to say, I'll admit, first of all, I'm half Ukrainian, so I'm a little bit biased on this thing. But I just finished the book Gulag Archipelago, and I'm thinking about what Putin's doing in Ukraine, and I'm saying to myself, I do not want to see a repeat of the early 20th century.
Amen.
Under Stalin, and I think Republicans got to be careful because this is something that we have to be worldwide and understand what's going on around us. This is not a small little thing. If you understand history, this could be a repeat of the early 20th century in that region.
Oh, Arn, I got to tell you, you and I couldn't agree more. The axis of evil is China, Russia, and Iran. And Russia has made a move to rebuild its Soviet sphere. And we are opposing it on behalf of a free but beleaguered people. And it's a very corrupt government. I know everything that's wrong with Ukraine. But they cannot spend bullets. They cannot spend a HIMARS. They can't steal a HIMARS, right? Now, someone will call up and say, oh, they could sell it to Iran. That's not happening. They're defending their soil, and you don't have to be half Ukrainian to understand this is a great power competition, and this is their weakest front at this moment. We won't fight Iran. Let's fight Russia.
Yeah, and keep in mind, the American people, I mean, my church is organizing to do relief in the Ukraine and so forth. There's a lot of people who are very sympathetic to the Ukrainian people, and I just want to warn Republicans to make sure you're on the right side of this argument. And I don't mean the backing Biden is necessarily good. I'm not a real fan of his, but what he's doing at least is something.
Yeah, well, we can hold two thoughts, right? Secretary Clinton said that to me on my show one time, and I've always used it. You can hold two thoughts at one time. Biden is a terrible president, and this is the best day of his presidency.
Agreed.
All right. Thank you, Arn. Jeremy, I don't know what you... Look, everyone's welcome to call 1-800-520-1234, pro or con. Jeremy, go ahead. You got a minute.
Yes, sir. Great to talk to you. I'm against the war, and this is why. I feel like I'm a veteran. I love our country, but I feel like we created the environment for this war to occur. And I feel bad for the Ukrainians who are dying. I feel bad for the Russians who are dying because of the leadership that has put this into motion. I just feel like we've been encroaching to the east, and we are now fighting a proxy war, and we're using other people's children to die in a war that we've created. And I hate to feel that way. I know it's unpopular, but that's how I feel. And
Jeremy, I'm glad to have your point of view. I don't think we created a vacuum. I think Putin is a deranged lunatic who's isolated and has a vision of the world that is deeply paranoid. And Obama's weakness invited him to go in. Biden's collapse in Afghanistan encouraged him to try and take the whole country. But two strikes doesn't mean you take the third one wildly. We play the hand we've been dealt, and this is the best thing he's done. But thank you for the call. ReliefFactor.com. There's the little pack. There's the big green and blue pack. Every single day, I would take it in the first hour as I did this hour. I hope sometime this afternoon, if the fetching Mrs. Hewitt is feeling good, and she's feeling better this weekend, by the way, flat on your back for 9 days will do that. The pain in the hip goes away, and took the MRI on Friday, so we'll find out tomorrow what the deal is. She's got a stress fracture in the femur. We don't know. Yeah, I just hope it's a tear in the tendon. But we'll find out tomorrow, and I'll tell you about it on Wednesday. But I got enough confidence I could leave the house for 90 minutes yesterday and go up the hill and back down the hill, and I'm feeling great because relieffactor.com works. Join the 500,000 people who take it every single day. That's right. 500,000 people take it every single day. Be one of them. $19.95 gets you started. It's a great thing. Let me also remind you, we had a great call on Friday from a MyPhDWeightLoss.com user, unsolicited, and his wife lost 50 pounds, just like Generalissimo did. It's an easy-to-follow program. Took 12 weeks for Dwayne to lose 50 pounds. He's kept it off for another 4 months. It's scientific. It is medically based. It is counseling based. It is not crazy cookie diets, not take these drops, not take these drugs. It's about changing the way you eat and what you eat. And Generalissimo did it, and now he's skinny Dwayne. And it works. MyPhDWeightLoss.com. Or you can call 864-644-1900. 864-644-1900. Did I say that again? 864-644-1900. The phones are jammed, and I will come back and take more phone calls after the break. The number is 1-800-520-1234. Now, I won't jump on someone and only leave them a half minute. Don't go anywhere, America. I will be right back on President's Day with President Biden in Ukraine. I'm live on the West Coast. It's Hugh Hewitt. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. On President's Day 2023, Joe Biden is in Kyiv. I'm not sure if he's still there. He was there an hour ago. And I'm taking calls. I applaud the president. It's the best day of his presidency. It's been a disastrous presidency, so that's a low bar, but it's still a very good thing. And I cannot overstate how important it is. I'm thinking of when Harry Hopkins landed in the United Kingdom during the Blitz. And he's the president FDR's best friend. And he comes and he spends weeks with Churchill. And he quotes the scripture to him, "Where you go, I will go." Book of Esther, right? Or is it the Book of Ruth? I don't know. It's "Where you go, I will go." And Churchill weeps because they're a beleaguered, war-torn country, the only one in the world standing up against the front line of the Panzers. At that point, it's prior to the invasion of Russia by Germany in 1940. And Hopkins supercharges the morale of a battered and bruised Great Britain. And Biden showing up in Kyiv is the same thing. It's the president of the United States of America, the most powerful nation in the world. I cannot overstate how important it is to Ukrainians. And that does not absolve the president of just the complete abdication of any leadership on East Palestine. It doesn't make him other than a remote and infirm figure in the United States domestic political world. But it is a great thing for Ukraine and freedom. John in Florida, what do you say, John? 1-800-520-1234.
Good morning. The greatest thing of his presidency. That's the first decent thing he's done for his presidency. But as far as this Ohio train wreck goes, I haven't heard you say one word about where is the Federal Railroad Administration. You know, there's supposed to be detectors all along to detect overheated journals and bearings.
Well, John, I have said a lot about East Palestine, most recently with Salena Zito in the first hour. And I hope you follow Twitter. There's a piece by James Strock about the infrastructure failure here. And it is it's a disaster. It has not been being paid attention to because it's on the Biden watch and they don't want people to pay attention to it. And it's in Ohio, a state they don't care about because they can't win it in a million years. Ohio's a deep red state now. And it's shameful, shameful what has not been done in Ohio. But I have talked about it, John. I'm sorry I missed it, but thank you for the call. James in Georgia. Go ahead, James. What's on your mind this morning?
Hugh, I have to respectfully disagree with you. This is not a Churchillian moment for Biden. He should be going to our border. That might be Churchillian. I support aid to the Ukraine, but having an 80-year-old man who is clearly suffering from dementia.
No, he's not, James. You don't have to, when we go a bridge too far, the efficacy of our arguments doesn't work.
Sir,
he doesn't have dementia.
I'm an expert in dementia.
Tell me about that. Why? Because someone in your family that's had it, so do I.
I've taken care of both of my parents with it.
And I've only done once, but I know what it's like. I know what full-blown Alzheimer's is. He's an old, infirm man, but he has not got dementia.
All right, sir. Alzheimer's is one of 13 kinds.
Enough, James. Thank you. I appreciate it. Non-physicians, he doesn't. Gosh, we're not going to win in 2024 with that kind of an attack. And I'm not going to entertain it. He does not. It is not the case. I don't believe his doctor would lie. I think he's an old, infirm man who hesitates, is losing capacity, loses the ability to take information in. He's cranky. He's old. He's difficult to deal with. And he walks in a profoundly old way. But showing up in Kyiv is a good, and it's the best thing he's done. Ed in Nevada. What do you think, Ed?
Yeah, well, in Germany, they had that Konrad Adenauer. They called him Der Alt.
Der Alt. You betcha.
Yeah. Now, I'm in my 60s. I think I'm too old. I think Trump's too old. I think Biden's too old. But, give him credit. Good job. I don't know what all the hand-wringing is about, if Trump did it or Carter did it.
Boy, that's a great point, Ed. If President Trump had shown up in Kyiv the always and only and sometimes Trumpers would be falling over themselves, and the never Trumpers would find a reason to say that it's bad. We can't program our responses to an American president going to Ukraine based upon his party or our belief in his electability or how bad or good he is. It is a discrete moment, and we all ought to applaud. Like when W showed up in Iraq, Thanksgiving of 2003, the left tried to find fault with that, and I thought, how stupid can you be not to recognize that it's a great thing when an American president goes to meet with his troops in a war zone? Same applies.
Exactly. Yeah, I don't see what, I mean, it doesn't bother. I'm not a big Biden fan, but, you know, give him credit for, I knew he was going to do this eventually, actually. I think a lot of people did.
And you got to do it at a time when it's not expected. Blinken's in Munich. Vice President Harris is in Munich. He's supposed to be in Delaware where he vanishes, or Camp David. And they pulled it off. And they'll get him out of there before Putin. You know, Putin wouldn't mind if a building fell on him. Then we'd have President Harris. Steve in Maryland. Hey, Steve, what do you think?
Well, you're right. If all you want is symbolism, it is just that. It's just symbolism. There's no reality to it. If it bolsters the Ukrainians, fine. How are the people in the trenches out in the middle of nowhere with no electricity and no water going to know that President Biden's in Kyiv?
Because Starlink, thanks to Elon Musk, has kept the country connected via the internet. They'll all know. Every single Ukrainian already knows. And they all have TVs. You know, someone in a trench somewhere might not know in Donbass, but every Ukrainian, except for the most forward soldier who's got a Russian in his sight right now and is targeting a HIMARS, and they'll know about it when they get back to base. So don't let the Russians brainwash you. Ukraine is fighting, and thanks to Elon Musk, they're connected. Bill in Oregon, all the way over to the other side of the coast. Bill, what do you think?
I lean toward the peace, and to me there's a lot of unanswered questions. We hear about how many casualties the Russians have had. I've never heard a number about how many Ukrainian casualties there have been.
It's close to the same number. It's devastating, and the one thing Russia has...
If the war continues, but I have to make a comparison to the Vietnam War. When I was there and I was able to talk to Vietnamese... They just wanted the war over. The average Vietnamese, they just wanted it over. Who wanted to keep the war going?
Bill, what years were you there? Bill, what years were you there?
I was there 69 to 70.
Okay, yeah. My brother-in-law preceded you, and then he went back as a co-van. Okay, Bill, thank you for the call. I don't think you can hear very well. My brother-in-law went back as a co-van. And the South Vietnamese were fighting with their lives during the last offensive, and they did not want the war to be over. They wanted freedom. And we did not supply them the tools that they needed, and Vietnam fell. Vietnam illustrates every reason why what Biden is doing is smart, and every reason why what we did then was wrong. And it wasn't we, Jerry Ford, it was we, the Democrats, cut off aid, just like they did in Afghanistan. And so Joe Biden is not erasing his history here. All that he's doing is the best thing of his presidency, and I applaud him for it. Joanne in Florida. Go ahead, Joanne.
Morning, Hugh.
Good morning.
He was a little late.
Very late.
At the beginning, he spoke of a small incursion that was going to take place.
Yep.
Well, look what happened to the small incursion.
You
he
betcha.
He should have done this long ago.
And before him, President Obama's weakness invited it. Joe Biden's collapse in Afghanistan encouraged the full-on invasion, and Putin had every reason to believe that Biden wouldn't do anything.
If he had done it for the right reasons, I would applaud him.
Well, do it now, thinking from the Ukrainian point of view. They don't know about how weak. I mean, they're fighting for their lives, right? If you're in a fight for your life, you have no idea what the guy four states away is doing on his block. But if he shows up, he might be the worst neighbor in the world, but if he shows up and you're in the fight for your life and he helps you, you thank him.
He's a useful pawn. They're a useful pawn at this point.
Not a pawn.
I applaud him. I'm glad he got out of there safely. But he did not do it for the right reasons, Hugh. Thank you.
Well, I don't know what his reasons were, but it's the right thing. Hey, Joanne, thank you. Charlie in Oklahoma, 1-800-520-1234. What say you, Charlie?
Well, I'm thinking that growing up a military brat and then joining the Army myself pre-9/11 and hearing my entire life about the strength of Russia and what a threat they were to us. And, you know, we were the strongest and they were second. And now they go over to Ukraine and can't beat that little place that's backwater. I'm wondering now, given the circumstances in Afghanistan, if this isn't a trap, that he's going to wait until we send everything we've got and then walk over there and just squash
it. No, it's not. And Charlie, I appreciate the concern. That is not the situation. Russia's vaunted military turns out to have been corrupted from the inside. Empty shell. They are now conscripting prisoners. They are now sending draftees. 500,000 Russians have fled the country. Their economy is slowly stroking out. And I would encourage you, go and run down my Twitter feed, find the Washington Post story on how dire it is in Russia. It is not a trap. It's a trap for Russia, and they've walked into it. It's worse than Afghanistan for them. They've lost 60,000 dead. 60,000 dead in a year. You know, we didn't lose that many in 20 years of Vietnam. And we lost 7,000 in 20 years in Afghanistan and Iraq. Russia doesn't know how to win a war, can't win a war, except if people stop aiding Ukraine, and we're not going to do that. I appreciate the call. Let me go to Sun in L.A. Good morning, Sun.
Good morning, Hugh. How you doing?
Good. You got 1 minute.
Hey, yeah, it's a charade. I mean, he's over there with the pomp and circumstance trying to get jets over there and more weapons and to escalate this continually. And if he didn't have this other element of corruption involved, funneling money and FTX and all these other variables.
No, son, I do not believe that for a second. There is no money laundering. That is internet conspiracy mongering. That's not happening. Biden's a terrible president. Understand me. But we don't have to accuse him of crazy stuff. That's just not happening. He's just incompetent and old. That's all that we need to know. But this is his best day. And I'm willing to salute him for that. 1-800-520-1234. Josh Kraushaar joins me next on President's Day. Stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by ConsumersResearch.org.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. 5 minutes ago, President Biden, according to the pool traveling with him, has departed Kyiv en route back to the United States. I'm joined by Josh Kraushaar of Axios. Good morning, Josh, on this President's Day. I think it's the best day of the presidency for Joe Biden, and certainly Ukrainians are cheering. What do you think?
Yeah, big moment for this White House. It may be one of the moments that we remember the Biden presidency, one of the highlights, him going into Kyiv, displaying a strong show of solidarity with the Ukrainian people, with Vladimir, with Zelensky. You know, I was struck, Hugh, that there wasn't a whole lot of analysis, commentary in the State of the Union that Biden gave about Ukraine, about foreign policy generally. And this was, I think, made up for that. I think he really offered a strong show of support at a very important time in this war.
I couldn't agree more. It's the best day of his presidency. And the impact on Ukrainians is what I'm trying to get people to understand who may not love Biden, and certainly a lot of my audience doesn't. But if you're in the middle of a war, I'm thinking of Churchill being visited by Harry Hopkins in 1940 and how that meant everything to Great Britain in the middle of the Battle of Britain, everything to have the United States on their side. And that's what's happening here.
Yeah, and we're at a pivotal moment in this, what seems like a long haul, a long stalemate. Russia's throwing all their manpower at this eastern line, and it doesn't seem to be getting far. But there's a lot of casualties and a lot at stake in the coming months. And morale means everything. Certainly, the money and the manpower and the military equipment that the Americans and our allies have been sending Ukraine is important, but the morale is as well. And I think this was a important show of support at a crucial time in the war.
Now, let me state now the second part of the argument. It's always the same with this White House. Two steps forward, three steps back. They do the best thing in the presidency, and they announce, by the way, we're sending $500 million more, and none of it is advanced weaponry. Don't worry, not advanced. It's like Jake Sullivan is walking back the impact of the president's trip, even as it's happening.
Yeah, I didn't see the latest statement by Jake Sullivan.
I'm not sure it's Jake. It's a unnamed, but Jake is with him. Jake Sullivan, the National Security Advisor, is with him, so I assume it's him.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes you see that there's a reticence from this White House. In fact, I was surprised that Biden, like I said, did not spend more time in his State of the Union talking about the high stakes in Ukraine winning the war against Russia. But look, there are political considerations. There are divisions within the Republican Party. There are divisions in the Democratic Party, to a lesser extent, about how much time, how much money, what types of weapons we should send. So they're very sensitive to the domestic politics. Usually they come around. Usually they've been continuing to give the support that Ukraine needs, the weapons that they need. But sometimes it takes a little while, and sometimes they're trying to kind of cross their T's, dot their I's, and make sure they got the politics straight.
Yeah, the F-16s are the biggest example, or the MiG-21s. The stuff they've stopped and then they grudgingly give. I just, maybe this will change it. You know, once you're in, you're all in, right? What happens if Ukraine collapses now? I mean, that they've got to understand that you can't lose after you've staked the presidency on it.
Well, and Hugh, there have been some signs, I would say elements within the administration that are a little cautious. There was a story in the Washington Post last week from a Biden official trying to, downplay expectations of more weapons, more money coming in the next year, and trying to figure out a resolution for some type of, end game. I don't think that's the majority sentiment within the administration, but there are voices that are more cautious, would like a settlement of some sort sooner rather than later. I think the majority of folks on the, in the administration want Ukraine to win. I want them to have successes on the battlefield. But, there is a worry that this could go on and there could be a whole lot of issues to come.
Well, I think it's 65-30, according to Gallup. 65% more aid, keep it up. 30% bring it to a halt immediately. And that 30%, I think, is distributed on the Bernie Sanders left and the Rand Paul right.
Yeah, well, I think a little more on the right. That's one of the bigger challenges, keeping the Republicans. I mean, I think Mitch McConnell, to a lesser extent, maybe a little bit McCarthy. I heard Mike McCall last week. I think he's going to hold hearings, just underscoring the brutality of what Russia's been doing in this war. Yeah, I think, you know, the old line Republicans are very much 100% behind the White House and behind Ukraine more broadly. But, you know, there is more anti-war sort of isolationist sentiment right now on the right. It's about 50-50 when you look at the polling among the Republicans, and independents and Democrats very, very much in favor of continuing to support Ukraine.
I haven't seen that number, but I'll be open to hearing it. I think Republicans will make a strategic error if they lurch isolationist. Reagan's peace through strength is the design. And I talked to Mike Pompeo about this a couple of weeks ago at the Nixon Library. It's not a new playbook. It's the old playbook. It's the playbook that brought down the Soviet Union and can, if used again, collapse the three-headed monster that is Iran, Russia, and, of course, Xi Jinping's CCP. Josh Kraushaar on Twitter and at Axios. Thank you. Happy President's Day. Don't go anywhere, America. Coming right back on The Hugh Hewitt Show. Hi, it's Hugh Hewitt. Eric McTaxas's new book, Letter to the American Church, is a must-read wake-up call for American Christians on what needs to be done now and, in fact, needed to be done yesterday. Get Letter to the American Church.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. The devastation in Turkey and Syria is simply overwhelming. It's beyond my experience, except for the Sri Lankan tsunami, the Haitian earthquake, the death toll at 15,000 and rising. You can contribute to the relief at the top of HughHewitt.com with food for the poor, or text Hugh to... No, I screwed that up. 91999, okay. Good morning, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. The devastation in Turkey and Syria continues to astonish. The death toll is above 15,000. We are running a relief campaign with food for the poor. The banner is at the top of HughHewitt.com, or you can text H-U-G-H to 91999. And stay tuned as we continue to cover this disaster on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
don't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
Morning Glory, America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. It's Hugh Hewitt on this President's Day 2023. And if you're just waking up, you set your alarm to me on the West Coast or in the Mountain West. President Biden went to Kyiv overnight. He's been in and has now left Kyiv, Ukraine's capital. He walked around with President Zelensky, promised $500 million more in aid, and then departed. This is the best moment of his presidency, in my view. I'm joined by Leland Vittert, anchor for News Nation. Good morning, Leland, on President's Day. I know what you'll be covering tonight.
Good morning, indeed. And I'm not sure anyone had a presidential visit to Kyiv on their bingo card, kind of like nobody had a Chinese spy balloon on their 2023 bingo card, but here we are.
Yeah, you know, James Homan, my colleague at The Post, just tweeted out, following months of meticulous planning, Biden huddled in the Oval Office on Friday with his closest aides for a go or no-go meeting on the trip to Kyiv. Unlike presidential trips to Iraq and Afghanistan, the U.S. has no military presence in Ukraine, making the trip riskier. I don't know if you've ever traveled on one of the surprise trips, Leland, have you?
I have not. I had a good friend who did and said it was one of the great moments of her life for obvious reasons. They basically take a very small group of the press corps a couple of hours before. You assemble typically at a garage somewhere not far from Andrews Air Force Base at a shopping mall. They take all your cell phones. They toss them in those RFID bags so you can't make any calls. You can't do anything. And they throw you on Air Force One and off you go.
And then you show up in Kyiv 12 hours later.
Or Iraq or Afghanistan or wherever else it is. So yeah, it's exciting. I think, you know, look, we had President Trump go to Iraq. We had also President Trump go to the DMZ, you know, when he met Kim Jong-un in other things and step over the DMZ, these kind of unannounced trips. I think you said it best when you said, the highlight of his presidency, because this is President Biden sort of doing everything that has to be universally liked in America, of a president appearing presidential to support an ally. And he does it, you know, is seen with vigor and seen walking off Air Force One after a 10-hour flight that left at 4 o'clock in the morning. This is a good thing.
And taking a train from Poland, I am told. I haven't got the details on the itinerary yet, Leland Vittert. Let me ask you about, it just astonishes me that somebody in the entourage then put out a statement, the president announces $500 million more in aid, and somebody says, but don't worry, none of it is advanced weaponry. That means it's not F-16s and M1 Abrams tank and the stuff that they need. I'm not sure that rules out HIMARS. It's almost like there are two presidencies at work here on Ukraine. Either you're with them or you're not.
I've heard that argument, and I make a point not to argue with people who are smarter than me, which includes you. That said, remember, every time that the Ukrainians ask for A, B, C, D, and E, we give them A and B, and we say C is possible, and D and E is not happening. And then about 2 months later, we give them D and E, and then we get, you know, the next five letters of requests, and on and on and on. We're almost all the way through the alphabet here. I'm not sure that that's all that meaningful that we're not giving them F-16s. The flip side of that is, I think what is meaningful is that we haven't gotten to the point where we're giving them anything that appears to be offensive, in which case we're treating Ukraine a little bit like we treated Afghanistan, in that we're trying to turn this into Russia's Vietnam, into Putin's Vietnam, rather than to actually give them the weapons to just fully beat the Russians.
Yeah, we've got thank you for the compliment. You're fully the equal of anyone in broadcast, including me. But Leland, my point, and you know, I'd ask everyone to think about this, is we don't want a Vietnam. I don't want 60,000 dead Russians. I want them to withdraw and leave Ukraine alone and rebuild Ukraine. But that ain't going to happen until they have another massive setback. I'm sure you read the Washington Post story on Putin in isolation, paranoid Putin. Now they've got people whispering at a bar that they're upset with Putin, and those people are getting arrested. It's like the return of Stalinism. And Iran, Russia, under the protection of China, it's just the new axis of evil, 2.0. I don't know why we are going to force the Ukrainians to take more casualties than they have to do just because we don't want to upset Russia with F-16s.
I couldn't argue with your logic there. I don't know if it's we just don't want to accept, you know, anger Russia. I think that there's sometimes it tends to be a little bit more complicated and nuanced look at these things, and it would take a couple of years to give them F-16s and train them on it. To your point, though, no better time to plant an oak tree than today, other than 10 years ago. Where I thought you were going with this, and what I think is interesting, is presidential time then says everything. It's why we're talking about Ukraine this morning. If he had just landed in Poland for, you know, the one-year anniversary in the Munich Security Conference, nobody would have really cared. So the flip side of this is on Wednesday we're going to see a split screen, right, of President Biden overseas and President Trump in East Palestine. And I think the pivot to foreign policy is really interesting because to a certain extent, George W. Bush was defined by foreign policy, but we really haven't had a president defined, and certainly a Democratic president, defined by foreign policy and foreign policy decisions since Carter.
I did not know that President Trump was going to East Palestine. By the way, five stars for pronouncing it correctly. As a Buckeye who grew up 30 miles from there, I'm very glad someone pronounces East Palestine correctly from the Ohio point of view.
I had a question for that. Did they change it when Palestine became something?
No.
That always
no. Everything in Ohio has got, like, Vienna, Ohio. All the literal people who settled Ohio and they set things up, they didn't know Palestine from Palestine, and they pronounced it that way. And the Ohio pronunciations often the Vienna is my favorite. Vienna, Ohio, home of the Vienna Mustangs, where my friend from high school, Tom Cornicelli, coached forever. That's my favorite. But there are lots of those funny Lima, right? Lima, Ohio. Everyone gets Lima, but you know, not many people know that. Leland, I got to ask you about Vivek Ramaswamy. What do you think of his toying with a presidential run?
Is he running for president or a Fox News contributorship?
No, he's president.
Really?
I think so.
Okay, well, I love to have him on the show. In fact, he has an open invitation. I don't know when the last time, I mean, I guess you could argue Trump, right? So do you argue that Vivek is going to follow the Trump playbook of becoming this outsider who is able to speak truth and develop this enormous brand? Is he going to beat Ron DeSantis at a primary among Republicans?
Well, you know, it presents an interesting dilemma to the RNC. You're going to have Vivek running, and you're going to have Larry Elder running on the West Coast, and they're both minorities, right? And do you keep them off the stage because they don't have a path to the presidency, or let them on and eat up time? I don't know the answer to that. Not my call, but it's an interesting dilemma for the RNC.
Is that presupposed that Nikki Haley does have a path to the presidency?
Yes, I think she does. I mean, she's won statewide. She's been the ambassador. She's well known. She'll poll in the single digits. It'll get her higher enough. She'll get a number of individual, well, I don't know what their metrics are. I would use a black box, but if you haven't won statewide, I don't know how you can.
You'll have the potential of Tim Scott on the stage too?
Yes. Yes. I think both of them have a path to the presidency that is, it's not easy, but it's not inconceivable. I don't know that Vivek's is inconceivable. I think Larry Elder's is. So I don't know what the rules are going to be, Leland. Do you have a suggestion?
Lots, but I try not to make suggestions. I just try to report on those that do. It's way more fun to Monday morning quarterback, which is why I love journalism.
Yeah, that is, by the way, that's my approach to everything in the presidential campaign. I have no opinion on any of the candidates, but I'll tell you what they're up to. Leland, thank you so much for joining me. I'll be watching you on News Nation tonight. I appreciate your taking the time early on a President's Day holiday. Again, the people who came to work today, they're happy because in the news business, because the story of the year for Joe Biden, other than not shooting down the Chinese spy balloon. I want to remind everyone, our friends at consumersresearch.org are great sponsors of this show. And I just saw a tape of a DEI seminar at the Department of Defense, and I'm shaking my head at ESG and DEI, spreading everywhere like kudzu across corporate America and across the administrative state. Consumersresearch.org keeps track of this craziness. They keep track of the companies that are giving away your money if you're a shareholder in pursuit of goals that only help the CCP and our enemies. ESG and DEI are code for far left. All right, that's it. far-left policies that pursue nothing of national greatness or shareholder return or wealth creation. It's all about wealth redistribution. It's all about an internationalist left-wing agenda that ought not to have anything to do with a well-managed, privately held corporation or publicly traded one, certainly, and certainly not in the DOD. I'll be right back, America. Don't go anywhere. 1-800-520-1234. What do you make of the president's trip to Ukraine? 1-800-520-1234. Connection to me, Hugh Hewitt. Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt on President's Day 2023, which is turning out to be the best day of a terrible presidency for Joe Biden. Credit where credit is due. Going to Kyiv is a bold move. It rallies the world, and it just absolutely supercharges Ukrainian morale in their long war against Russia. And bravo, President Biden, you got something right. And, you know, everything else is wrong, and it does not erase Afghanistan. It doesn't absolve neglect of East Palestine. It doesn't make us forget inflation or the fact that he's infirm or the fact that he said we're still going to need oil in 10 years or any of the other, don't shoot down this balloon, shoot down these balloons. It's all incoherent, but this is a good day, the best day. Let me go to Minnesota called Dan. What do you think, Dan? I'm Hugh Hewitt. Welcome.
Oh, good morning, Hugh. You kind of just answered my question by saying everything is incoherent, because I was going to ask you to please speculate on President Biden and his administration's overall strategy and game plan of laudably supporting Ukraine while at the same time shockingly not controlling the southern border and the withdrawal from Afghanistan. So you kind of answered my question before I asked it.
Right, it's incoherent, but let's call the good days the good day, right? There's been one.
Okay.
You know, I point out, they could have prevented this whole dang thing if they'd only made some declarations of robust support beforehand, if President Obama hadn't been so weak, and if they wouldn't parcel out the aid. It's incoherent, but it's the best day of a terrible presidency. That's my answer.
Yeah, gotcha.
Thank you, Dan. Let's go to Georgia and Jim. What do you think, Georgia, Jim?
Well, I think this is, you know, even with all my conservative misgivings about President Biden, I'm seeing the leader of the free world in Kyiv, a battered, beleaguered ally of ours. And I have to also believe that Xi Jinping is not really enjoying this trip of Biden's right now. And Taiwan is probably looking at like, yeah, you attack us, he might be here in Taiwan one day.
Jim, well put. You know, the world watches. And I know, you know, I've had some callers who are very upset that he hadn't been to East Palestine, and I agree with them, and the southern border, I know that. But in the grand strategic competition in which we are engaged, in which my grandchildren will be engaged in with China, this matters a lot.
Amen.
Thank you. You know what else matters? The 10-year treasury. I'm not absolving President Biden for just ferociously terrible economic plans. The 10-year treasury this morning is at 3.828%, creeping up again. It's been as high as 4.25%. That makes it harder to buy a house. You want to lock in your rate right now. If you're going to move, if you're going to buy a house, you want to lock in your interest rate right now. Do not delay another day. Don't wait another moment. Call Andrew and Todd with Sierra Pacific Mortgage, andrewandtodd.com, 888-888-1172. You may not be working today, but they will be answering and returning your phone calls. You can fill out the online form and tell them what you're looking for and where, and they will get everything ready for you, and they will give you a pre-qualification letter so you can walk right in, sit right down. If I had a producer, I could get walk right in, sit right down, but I don't, so I won't. But you can walk right in, sit right down with andrewandtodd.com. They love to talk to you. If you're a senior citizen and you're wondering, how do I get, I don't have enough money, I'm stretched, I didn't save enough, and Biden has ruined my shopping cart, and the inflation is to get a reverse mortgage. They're the ones to help you walk through that. You can trust them. John in Atlanta. Hello, John. What do you say?
Hi, Hugh. I think what bothers me is having Biden's name associated with Churchill. Churchill was a nobleman. I think he was a principled man and had integrity. Biden is none of that. And
the fact that I'm using Harry Hopkins' trip to war-torn Great Britain in 1940 as an analog does not make Biden Churchill by any means.
I know, but I can just see what the mainstream media would do with that, though, because they're going to try to make it that way.
Well, it ain't going to work, because Churchill stayed there every day of the war. Right. Well, not every day of the war. He went on very long foreign trips that were onerous on his health and almost killed him. In fact, I think he had a heart attack in Egypt. And he went to the Soviet Union two or three times. He went to the Tehran conference. He went to Yalta after the war. I mean, Churchill was Churchill, but that's not this. So, John, I don't think we have to worry about that. Anyone who tries to make that argument that Biden is Churchill, that's absurd. I'm talking about the impact on morale in the Ukrainians.
Yeah, I listened to you and Dr. Larry Arnn on Fridays, and I learned a lot about Churchill. And in principle, Biden is not.
All right. Well put. ReliefFactor.com, great sponsor of the show. There's the familiar bag if you're watching on the Salem News Channel. ReliefFactor.com is the most visible, beautiful bag. It's so well designed, but what matters is what's inside the packet. The four tablets I take every morning, the four pills, easy to swallow. I carry in curcumin, resveratrol, and omega. Very easy to take. I take it every day. Did my 5 miles yesterday. Hopefully do that again today. Beautiful day in Southern California yesterday, as everyone will tell you. It's President's Day. I want to get out and about, fetching with Hewitt, feeling better. I'm feeling better about leaving her alone for 90 minutes to an hour or so. And I want you to know, ReliefFactor.com will help you get back in the game. If you've got minor aches and pains that need relieving because of exercise or aging, and you're going to do both today, I hope, get older and maybe exercise, ReliefFactor.com. Join the 500,000 people who take it every day, including me, Hugh Hewitt, on air live every single morning because, boy, it works. ReliefFactor.com. Don't go anywhere. 1-800-520-1234. I'm so glad I came to work today. The best day of the Biden presidency. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. I'm trying to get as many reactions as possible to President Biden's trip, now complete, to Kyiv. He has left Kyiv. He went overnight. If you're just waking up and you're just tuning in, President Biden made a surprise trip on President's Day to Kyiv, walked around the war-torn capital of Ukraine with President Zelensky, announced another $500 million in aid. It is the finest day of a terrible presidency. And you can hold two thoughts at once, and those are my two. It's the best day Biden has had. It's huge for Ukraine, and we should recognize that. Let's go to Jeff in Pennsylvania. Hello, Jeff.
How you doing, you? Where is the UN on all this?
I have no idea, and I really don't care. The UN is a dysfunctional, broken disaster of,
Why do we give $20 billion a year?
We shouldn't. We shouldn't. I think, look.
How come no politician mentions that? I talked to John McCain one day. He says, the UN does great things.
Well, I can't speak for the former senator from Arizona. All I can tell you is we don't need if we waited for the UN to do anything right, we wouldn't do anything right in the world. And the Security Council has a veto in China's hand and in Russia's hand. So they're not going to do anything on this, and they never do anything on anything that matters. But thank you, Jeff. John in Florida, what do you think, John?
Good morning, Hugh. Remember the Lusitania was sending carrying munitions to England during World War One, and was sunk by a German U-boat?
Yes. I don't remember it. I wasn't alive, but I know of the occasion.
Well, I'm telling you, this is a wrong move. Joe Biden is not Ronald Reagan or Donald Trump. He's a coward. He ran out of Afghanistan. He already sent the wrong signals. We shouldn't be in Ukraine.
Well, you know, we can agree on he blew Ukraine. I don't think he's a coward, because cowards don't go to a war zone like this. I think that actually kind of bold and courageous move. But everything's been too little and too late, finally getting ahead of the curve. And this is the front line in a long, long conflict with China, Russia, and Iran. And Putin is China's puppet, and he's a paranoid, and we are fighting for freedom there. And our NATO allies know fully well, if Putin gets Ukraine, Article 5 is next in line. Got to grind him down there. Got to. Steve in Ohio. Hello, Steve. You're on the Hugh Hewitt Show. Good morning. 1-800-520-1234. 1-800-520-1234.
Hugh, longtime listener. Love your show. Very thought-provoking.
Thank you. Which part of Ohio are you in?
I'm in Cleveland, south of Cleveland.
Well, I don't know how our guys did at the All-Star game last night. I haven't read that yet, but go Cavs.
Well, but I have to let you know, I'm a transplant from Pittsburgh.
So. Oh, no! False flag operation.
We've been here for 26 years. Love it.
Are you rooting for the Browns or for the Steelers?
Steelers, of course.
You see, false flag, but I'll let you go on anyway. What do you think about Biden and Ukraine?
Okay, unfortunately, look, I support the Ukrainian people. Putin's an evil thug, but I think this is the crassest of political moves. The moment that it's not to Biden's political advantage, he'll abandon them the same way that he abandoned Afghanistan. And the bigger picture, strategy, in what universe do we think that Putin is going to just withdraw?
Oh, I think you need to, I just tweeted a reply of the Washington Post story yesterday on Putin's Russia, and how the oligarchs and some senior Kremlin people are beginning to whisper, what is he doing to the country? Because there are 60,000 dead Russian boys, and there are 500,000 Russian men who have fled the country, and it's breaking down. It's falling apart. And he's got a special train. He is a nut, all right? So there is a moment coming, a Khrushchev moment. Are you old enough, Steve, to remember when Khrushchev just disappeared?
Yes, I am. And here's the other thing. Look, let's follow words of advice from Obama and Gates about Biden, okay? Never underestimate his ability to mess things up.
Well put. And, thank you for family-friendly quotes.
And he's been wrong on nearly every foreign policy and national security issue in 40 years.
I think Gates said all of them. Not nearly all. I think he said all of them. He's never been right. But you know what?
I looked it up.
Blind squirrels, right? Yeah. Blind squirrels and nuts. He got one.
I know. My concern is, look, if our goal is to topple Putin, it would be less expensive, less ways of less people getting killed than this.
It isn't our goal to topple Putin. It is our goal to get Ukraine and keep it free. And if Putin wants to keep fighting, we got to keep giving them the tools so they can finish the job. Thank you, friend. I got lots of people lined up, so I want to move on. Cliff in Missouri. Hey, Cliff.
Hugh, you were so off base on this one. This is not an American war like it's becoming under Biden. This is a Europe war. And if the Europeans are so concerned about their security over there, let them start ponying up a trickle of what the U.S. has paid over there so far.
It's well, I think percentage of GDP, you're right to point out Europe has lagged behind us. President Trump originally put that on the table. Everybody but Germany has stepped up. Germany is a completely useless ally in my view, but the rest of them are stepping up, and indeed Boris led the way, and Rishi is sort of following behind. He's screwing up the Brexit right
they
now.
They started, and then they stopped.
Like they haven't stopped. That's not correct, Cliff.
Next to nothing.
That's not correct, Cliff. That's not correct.
Where is the vote in our U.S. Congress to be given the Ukrainians this money?
Oh, we did vote for that. Cliff, we did vote for that.
We didn't vote for all of it, have we not?
We did, in fact, in the now, you might object to the omnibus and the way that it passed, but it was
exactly right.
But it was in the omnibus, so it was voted on. So, Cliff, I'm glad you called, but I want to move on. But if you make three mistakes in one call, you got to go back and check your facts. You're wrong on they're going to nothing. You're wrong on Great Britain, and you're wrong on the Congress voting. So when you're wrong three times in a minute, you got to go back and start reading. Sam in Arizona, what do you think, Sam?
Hi, Hugh. Well, I think, number one, it's pretty clear that the American people are tiring about Ukraine.
That's not correct, Sam. Sam, Gallup put out the poll yesterday. 65% support our policy. 30% want us to get the war over with. So 65% is a super majority.
What I saw was 48% do not want to send any more money. There was a poll last week. 48%.
Trust Gallup on this, Sam. Money. Trust Gallup. Okay, Gallup is the best, and they've been doing it the longest, and I trust Gallup. I don't know about another poll that you saw. 65% in Gallup said send more stuff.
My group, my friends, we're all tired of it. But going on, I'm not a big fan of sparkling objects. Joe Biden going to Ukraine, it's not a difficult thing to do. He fires up Air Force One, he lands, he goes. I think it's a diversion, and 2 weeks from now, it won't mean a thing.
I think you're thinking like
squadrons of F-16.
And Sam, thank you. I don't want to talk over you, so I'll put you on hold. Thank you. It will mean everything to Ukrainians for a long time. Now, it will not mean anything to us because Biden's a terrible president, and the presidency can't be fixed by a show of support, but it will matter a great deal to Ukraine. It matters to Xi, Putin, and Khamenei, and that they won't forget. And we will, because you can't not look at East Palestine and say, what in the world is Biden doing at home? And why is this so late and so little? But you can say, well done, Mr. President, on one day. Ed in L.A., good morning, Ed.
Hi, you. I agree with you on a lot of things, but boy, I'm 100% against this. We ought to be looking for a peaceful way out. This is a disaster, and I worry more about this World War III and nuclear Russia, and they aren't going to lose. Putin's not going to lose. He has incredible support in Russia, and I think that you are misled on this.
Well, Ed, I appreciate the call. Thank you for calling. I'd encourage you to go read, if you go to my Twitter account, hit the tweets and replies. I just replied to someone who agrees with you with the piece in the Washington Post that talks about the fragility of Russia right now. They are close to buckling, breaking, and Putin may not know it because he's a paranoid, he's an isolation unit, basically. But there's a Khrushchev moment coming there, and I think we ought to be aware of that. Thank you, Ed. Doug in Texas. What do you think, Doug?
Thanks for taking my call. Yeah, I think
you know, listening to your listeners, they've all got a good perspective. It's a dangerous bet that Biden, dangerous trip that Biden did. And the reason why is because the United States has not been at a level of indebtedness that it ever has before in its history. And the pressure of bankruptcy or, you know, running out of money is not a good formula to support Ukraine.
Let me correct one thing, Doug. We have been, as a percentage of GDP, this much in debt once before in World War II. But there was a plan to get out of debt, and we don't have a plan right now. And we're at $31 trillion on our way to $50 trillion, and the interest payments alone will cripple the economy. It's got to stop.
Correct. So it's a choice between two evils. I just think we should be looking at other options, including letting them take Ukraine and fight.
Oh, gosh, no. It's so much cheaper. So much cheaper to fight the axis of evil, China, Russia, and Iran in Ukraine than it is by giving them Ukraine. I mean, that's just, you don't give them Great Britain to stop Hitler later. It is... That's just wrong, but I appreciate the call, Doug. Wesley in Georgia. Hello, Wesley.
Hello, Mr. Hewitt. I don't believe that we've had a congressional declaration of war against Russia, and you're on the wrong side of history supporting Ukraine.
Well, okay. We haven't had a declaration of war because we're not at war with Russia. We are supplying aid to an ally that was approved by Congress, but there is no authorization for the use of military force in Russia. And there won't be Americans fighting Russians. And we don't want that. But I appreciate the call. Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, I believe that you're not remembering George Washington's requirement that we not involve ourselves in foreign conflicts.
Well, I do remember his farewell address, but I also remember that that was in the 1796. And a lot has changed. And FDR, Ronald Reagan, Donald Trump, all believed in protecting America's interest abroad, and the world has changed. Thank you, though, Wesley. Final segment of your calls, 1-800-520-1234. Vigorous debate, that's what we're all about. The news you want, the analysis you need, the callers from all across the spectrum. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Thank you so much for listening today. I want to get one more call or more calls in at 1-800-520-1234. After the show, the Grand Old Pod will be dropping as well. I'm going to talk about Nikki Haley, about Kamala Harris on this President's Day, about all the other things that happened over the weekend in the presidential competition. And later on, the highly concentrated Hugh podcast, which is different from the Grand Old Pod. You only get the Grand Old Pod if you subscribe to the universe. And that's sort of my day-by-day, blow-by-blow, the Republican Party news for Republicans, by a Republican, and anyone else who's interested in actually understanding what the center-right believes about the world. That's where you get it, in the Grand Old Pod. Pure politics. This morning's news, though, I'll talk about the Keeve trip as well in the Grand Old Pod, but you've got to subscribe to the universe to get that. I want to tell you about the trip the president made today. I want to leave you with this thought. It's a terrible presidency. He's a failed president, and he's infirm. But this is the best day of a bad presidency. And for the Ukrainian people, it is terrific. It is what they needed, and they got it. John in L.A. Good morning, John.
Good morning, Hugh. How are you, sir?
I'm great. Good morning on the West Coast. You're up early.
Yes, sir. Trying to beat the 405 traffic to South Orange County before it becomes the nightmare that you know it is.
Yeah, I know it, but it's not possible to do that. I think you left too late, but it is President's Day, so you might be okay. It might be Monday morning light.
Exactly. Hey, real quick, Hugh, 22-year Army veteran, did counterintelligence, worked for outfit agencies as contractors. I am a center-right Republican. I enjoy listening to you in the mornings on my way to work. You are a breath of fresh air. The folks that are opposed to this, I agree with you 1,000,000%. You know, this is the atrocity of this Biden administration, the wanton spending on insane projects, as opposed to supporting our allies in the Ukrainians, and the massive geopolitical implications of this Russian incursion, which, as we remember, started under Obama, the red line with Crimea, and has slowly crept. So for the folks that sit down and say we shouldn't be supporting, this is a European conflict, what would have happened in 1939? Had Neville Chamberlain actually have the guts to do something against Adolf Hitler instead of capitulating? Thank you so much for all that you do, Hugh.
John, well put, as only a 22-year veteran would be able to do it and succinct. Obviously, you study grand strategy and history, and I want people to think of it from three perspectives. Four, the perspective in Beijing of Xi, the perspective in Tehran of Khamenei, and the perspective in Russia of Putin, and then the perspective of the average Ukrainian in the street. And it's just so important to separate Joe Biden's almost legendary incompetence and lassitudinous conduct of the presidency from this day where he did a good thing. Thank you, John. Jim in Ohio, what do you say, Jim?
Hey, good morning, Hugh. I guess I question the President Biden's available bandwidth. There's so many issues domestically going on, and literally fires everywhere across our country, specifically in Ohio with the train accident. And I can't applaud him, his focus on going elsewhere. When, like I said,
let me give you a thumb to chew on, Jim.
And if I could also, this issue all started when he pulled out of Afghanistan.
Yes.
And demonstrated to the world that we have weak leadership. And
yes.
This is not going to, this little photo op that he's doing in the Ukraine is not going to overshadow that. You shouldn't allow it to happen.
Jim, thank you so much. I got to wrap up the show. You're right that the collapse in Afghanistan invited Putin aggression. But it's the best return on investment for a president who can't talk, cannot give interviews, cannot persuade. Show up at the place where a photo does matter. Show up and issue a statement in the one place in the world where showing up matters when you are lacking verbal dexterity and are fragile. He's an infirm guy. He's an old infirm guy. So it's not easy. He could have slept on Air Force One all the way there, and we don't know quite how he got in and out. He left Kyiv at about 7 a.m. Eastern time this morning, according to Poole. There have been reports he took a train from Poland to Kyiv. We don't know because they're, it's dangerous. It's just dangerous. It's dangerous for everyone in Ukraine to go anywhere. But the president did that. It was bold. It has ramifications throughout the world. Maybe it will encourage the Germans to get off the freaking fence and make up their minds that this is their war too. But it doesn't, you don't have to be, you're not a Biden supporter because you applaud something he did. Don't make that mistake. As Secretary Clinton told me, you can hold two thoughts. And I've always held on to that. One thought, it's a terrible presidency. Second thought, it's the best day of a terrible presidency. And it's President's Day 2023. And I want to thank Adam and Jacob and Dwayne for working and getting us ready to go and being here live for you on a day of importance in the world and in Ukraine. Thank you so much. If you go over to the universe, the grand old pod, we'll talk to you about Nikki Haley and about Kamala Harris's terrible interview yesterday with Andrea Mitchell, and so much more on the grand old pod at the universe. Stay tuned, America, to this great radio station. I'll talk to you tomorrow here on the Salem News Channel across the United States airwaves. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Thank you for listening.